binding some, with antibodies binding to the epitopes of that bacteria, so. So you have a constant region, and that is identical among different types of antibodies. So these are the constant ones. And then it has variable regions, and these then are unique to a specific type of antigen, and it binds to those epitopes and it's the variable ones. Binds to the epitopes on the antigen. So these variable parts, you have an antigen off of, say, an E. coli bacteria, those will be specific for that. The variable part will be specific for that particular antigen. There's five classes of antibodies or immunoglobulins. And there's a table on page 474 of your book, and then it shows the pictures of these as well. So one of the first one is called IgM. That one is the largest, and that M stands for macromolecule. It's a pentamer. That means what we've drawn over here is a monomer. Just one, you know, antibody with the two arms. So the pentamer is five of these. They're joined together by a J chain, which is a joining chain. And they make up about 6% of the antibodies that are in the serum. The serum is the fluid portion of the blood. Because they're so big, made up of five of those, they don't leave the blood vessels, and you don't find them then in the tissue fluids. It's one of the antibodies that are bound to the B lymphocyte as a cell surface receptor. And it's the first to appear after B cell stimulation, but they don't last very long, so they decline pretty quickly. So if you did a blood test and you found these IgM antibodies in the blood, that it would indicate a recent infection. It's the predominant antibody that's in the ABO blood group antigen reaction. And as that IgM binds to antigen, it also activates complement. The complement were those proteins that float around in your blood all the time. And then it causes microbes to clump together. Because we can have but it has those it has hem binding sites because there's five of those monomers together. Kind of in a circle together. So it can bind one, say one monomer could bind to one bacteria, maybe antibody, one monomer could bind to two bacteria. It could be two different bacteria. And so the bacteria then start clumping together. Then you could have another IgM molecule that is in that, and pretty soon you have a bunch of antibodies with a bunch of black bacteria that are all clumped together. IgG, that stands for gamma globulin, also a monomer, and that accounts for 80% of the antibodies that are in the serum. These appear between 24 and 48 hours after the antigenic stimulation. And this antibody raises if you get a booster shot from some vaccine that you have. They provide long-term resistance to disease as a product of the memory B cell. This IgG also crosses blood vessel walls, taking her into the tissue fluids. And it is the antibody that crosses the placenta when the mother has a baby inside of her. And then that it imparts about 6 months of immunity to the baby after it's born. The IgG protects against circulating bacteria and viruses, can neutralize toxins, and it can trigger the complement system. So if it's bound to that antigen also, and if it's bound to the antigen, then it makes them larger, and then it makes it easier for the phagocytes to phagocytize them. IgA, about 13% of the total antibodies in the normal serum. Higher, it's more than 13% if we're talking about the mucous membranes and the body secretion. It prevents attachments of pathogens to mucosal surfaces. And mucosal surfaces are one of the leading portals of entry. What is the respiratory system, the mucous membranes of the respiratory system is the number one portal, you know, most things come in through that portal of entry. There's two types of IgA. One's the one in the serum, that's the one with the 13% of the serum, and it's just a monomer, just like what we drew. And then there is the second type is secretory IgA. That's two of those monomers together, and they're joined by a J chain. And this secretory IgA is found in gastrointestinal fluids, nasal secretion, saliva, tears, colostrum. And that imparts immunity to the baby. IgE is 0.002% in the serum, the monomer. And IgE is the one that is plays an important role in allergic reactions by sensitizing cells to certain antigens. It's a primary role of IgE is to amplify the body responses to invaders. It also combined to the FC portion of the antibody. So it can also bind to the basophils and the mast cells. And those are the cells that in immune reaction are responsible for the chemical mediators that, like histamine, that would cause an allergic reaction to the symptoms. And these are inflammatory reactions, and the inflammatory reactions attract complement and phagocytic cells. IgE is the antibody that is responsible for attacking helminths, the parasitic worms, binds to those helminths. And patients with allergies or helminth infection have elevated levels of IgE if you do a blood test on them. IgD is less than 1% of this in the little serum. For the antibodies, the monomer. You find IgD on blood and lymph and on B cell surfaces. It's a cell surface receptor on the B lymphocyte. So together with IgM, that's also a cell surface receptor on the lymphocyte. And it can bind to antigens and also signal the B cells to differentiate and make antibodies. So here's a picture, the second one there that is the monomer, I mean, made up of 5 monomers. That's a pentamer IgM, not the molecule. And so each one of these parts of the antibodies, since there's 5 of them, there's 10 binding sites that can bind to antigens. The lymphatic system, it's intertwined with the cardiovascular system, and both systems are circulating body fluid. The cardiovascular system circulates blood within the blood vessels, and certain components of the blood, as it moves through the system and goes down to smaller and smaller vessels, gets to the capillaries, and then this fluid, the blood can leave those capillaries and go into the tissue spaces. And then once that happens, then the fluid is called interstitial fluid. And that interstitial fluid then is picked up by the lymph system. And once it gets into the lymph system, then we call it lymph. And as the lymph is transported, it is filtered through lymph nodes. And those lymph nodes are along the lymphatic vessels. And within those lymph nodes are macrophages, and macrophages are cell-eating part of your immune system. So as your lymph is getting circulated through your lymph nodes, we have macrophages that already start to destroy bacteria and cancer cells and anything that doesn't belong there before it even enters the venous system. Lymph nodes are part of both the innate and the adaptive immunity, and they're situated along the path of the lymphatic vessels. So if you get swollen lymph nodes, got lymph nodes here, in your armpits and your groin, to name a few, that can indicate that you have an active infection, and your lymphocytes going after the infection and multiplying. So the nodes contain both B cells and T cells, which are lymphocytes, and the lymph nodes are also where the antibodies are getting produced. They also have phagocytes in the lymph node. And those are busy working, trying to destroy the microbes and stimulate the immune system's response. So that's your lymphatic system. And that one's saying that the primary lymphoid organs are the bone marrow and the thymus. And your lymphocytes, they get to a certain stage, they originate in the bone marrow, and then they mature in different areas depending whether they're a B lymphocyte or a T lymphocyte. Secondary lymphatic organs are the lymph nodes. Lymphocytes are small white blood cells, and they have, if you're looking